Good morning, church, and it's nice to see you all here on this kind of cold, blustering day. Yesterday was blustery. Oh, really? Anyways, we will now have our announcements. Mrs. Sally?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I see you all got your clock set correctly and made it here.
Miracles still happen.
As did I, yes, even though I lost that hour. Tomorrow I have to get up because I have an appointment, so I'll make it up somewhere along the line. These are your morning announcements. Maple Syrup Weekend is coming up on Saturday, which is this coming Saturday. So that means we won't be together again until this Saturday.
Yes, we will.
And I won't be able to make, well, yes, Thursday at a soup supper, yes. But I won't be able to, no one will be able to make this announcement to you and because we will be gathering for pancakes and maple syrup. Open to the whole congregation, not just the short people. Tall people may go also. We should be there by 9 a.m. to enjoy a pancake breakfast. There will be many activities for kids. The cost is $12 for adults and $7 for kids 12 and under. I wonder if I walk on my knees, they would go eat. Anyway, I digress. The address is 625 County Road 28, Palmyra, New York, 14522. A group of us are planning on carpooling. If you are interested, we are planning on leaving the church parking lot by 8:15. So, you know, that doesn't mean roll in here at 8:17 because we'll be gone. So be here before 8:15. Okay? Two of our youngest members, is this right? Is it still time? Okay. I heard a rumor, so Haley and Bella are once again having a bottle and can drive to support the American Heart Association. Oh, be nice, Sally. Today is the collection day. Don't miss it. Be nice. So if you have any cans and bottles at home, you want to run home after and bring them up, they'll take them. In place of our annual Easter egg hunt, New Beginnings is sponsoring an Easter egg trunk hop. You know, back in my day, I did some trunk hopping. We won't go there. It will be Saturday, April 9th from 1 to 3 p.m. And the idea is the same as the trunk or treat that we did back in October. Celebration of Halloween. So this is going to be similar to that, but it's going to be on a theme of, for Easter. So decorate your cars and trunks for Easter and hand out Easter candy. New Beginnings will supply some treats and filled eggs in the social hall. Start thinking of ways to decorate your car and a costume you might wear. I know for a fact that the Easter Bunny will be there. Mm. I have an inside line to the Easter Bunny. There are free COVID test kits available. Is this true?
Yes.
In the narthex and the social hall, please help yourself. Even if you got some last week, help yourself again. Take some to your family and friends also. Do be aware that there is an expiration date on these test kits. Once the date is passed, it may give you a false reading. So just be aware of the date. On Sunday, March 27th, that's in 2 weeks, we will once again take up a collection for one great hour of sharing. Please be generous to our neighbors in need. And I think you got a little reminder in your bulletin this morning about that. Our Lenten soup suppers are ongoing this month and into April. After soup supper, the stimulating conversation will take place. Pastor Sue, Richard Knight, and Mike Staub are the team working to facilitate the conversation. This past Thursday, March 10th, we had a wonderful and passionate discussion about being born again. And during social hour, if you go around and find people who attended that, I think that they will agree to that statement. Below is the schedule for the following meetings. March 17th, Richard Knight will speak on God Walk, and it's a discussion. It's just not one main speaker. March 24th, Mike Staub will lead us in the discussion on the seven last words to the cross. March 31st, Mike Staub will lead us in the discussion on the seven last words from the cross. April 7th, Pastor Sue, Mike, and Richard will talk on the stations of the cross. And April 14th, Pastor Sue will have a Monday Thursday service that is during Holy Week. Please plan on joining us. We've had great soups and we've had great conversation so far. Ladies of the church, it's tea time. Not meaning golf. Come join Pastor Sue for tea on Friday, March 18th at 2 p.m. at 12 Malay Circle, Pittsburgh, and RSVP. Her phone number is there, and we'll see you for tea.
At two. I hope you can come.
Two for tea. Okay. And she hopes to see all the ladies at her.
Will we be forced to sing that?
I don't know. I just want a cute little pair of gloves, though. Hats? I don't care. You know, just come and have fun. It's for fun.
Okay. Proceeds from the joy jar this week and next go to Ukraine Relief. And I don't know if anybody had the TV on this morning on that today, Sunday morning today on Channel 10, but boy, there were some heartwarming stories on there. Calendar of events. Today there was a cabinet meeting. Grab your snacks and we'll get the meeting rolling. Lenten Soup Supper Bible Study at 6 p.m. We start with soup first, and Richard Knight will lead us in that discussion. March 23rd, the beginnings will have a meeting at 6. And those are the near upcoming events. In our community, there is a spaghetti dinner to benefit the Seneca Place Fire Relief Fund, which will be held on Thursday, March 31st from 2 to 6 at 31 East Street across from the high school in Honeywood Falls, I think.
That's what I took it as. It does not say on the poster, it says, yeah.
Right. Hands of Hope free lunch is every Wednesday at noon at St. Bridget's Catholic Church in Bloomfield. A free lunch at East Bloomfield Methodist Church on the third Thursday of each month. Community lunch and fellowship. Doors open at 11:30. Lunch is served 12 to 1. All are welcome. Free will offering is accepted. The church is handicapped accessible. If you have joys and/or announcements, please share them with Ellie Babcock and her email address, ellie807@aol.com. The community bulletin board is available for community use. If you have something to be posted, please leave the item in the New Beginnings mailbox or mail it directly to our church. Thank you to me. And our greeters, Steve and Jan Schrader. Next week, we have Donna Parsons as the liturgist, Linda Ensman and Carol O'Dell will greet and farewell us. and the fellowship hour will be brought to us by Diane Marcellus and Gloria Miles. And next week is also Birthday Cake Sunday, celebrating January, February, and March birthdays. And the 27th, Catherine will be our liturgist. Maybe?
No, I'll be in, probably in Iceland at that time.
That's been taken care of, I believe.
Okay, thank you.
Jean Bidwell and Richard Knight are our greeters and farewell. And Mike and Fran Staub are our fellowship folks. March birthdays are listed as printed. And no matter where you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. We are in the United Church of Christ. I do have one addition. As I drop the pens and pencils. We received this note. To all you caring friends, it has been wonderful to know that so many of you are talented in so many ways. We appreciate it. My cards and messages lift my spirits. Thank you so much, Norma and Richard.
Oh. I think Kate has a message. Kate, did you have an announcement?
Kate has an announcement?
Oh, yes. I volunteered down in Holcomb at the community support shop. And now that spring is here and we are cleaning out our homes and sorting through our clothes, that is a good place for the things you don't want and they're in good shape to donate. Just to let you know that I have three categories when I sort. The best of the best goes to the shop. The second best goes up to Rochester through the homeless shelters. And the third best goes to a organization that picks up clothing and they are sent to third world countries. So nothing is wasted. So whatever is donated there, it either stays in the community or it goes around the world. Nothing is wasted. And just to let you know that that is a good place to take it because it will all be used.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kay. Anyone else have an announcement? All righty. We will begin our worship service. Life-giving God, show us these days of Lent how to appreciate the ordinary as sacred.
Use our lives with love, your love. Awaken our passion for you.
Walk with us these holy days of Lent. And now we will do our call to worship. When we stumble and our faith falters, God's faithfulness is with us.
And our spirits soar and our faith grows strong, God's faithfulness is with us.
When our daily duties distract us, and our visions become fuzzy, God's faithfulness is there to pierce the fog.
We lift our hearts in praise to the One who is God, this day and forevermore.
God's faithfulness endures forever.
Thanks be to God.
Our opening hymn this morning is in the Black Hymnal 199, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed.
Please stand if you're able.
Thank you.
me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, you call to us to follow your Son this Lenten season,
to follow him into the heart of suffering
and struggle in order to bring your people mercy, healing, and new life. You ask us to carry out the mission of Jesus in our time.
Holy One,
give us the self-knowledge and courage to change our lives
as we confront the power of sin in the world around us.
We know that the journey will not be an easy one as we walk with Jesus from hallelujah to Calvary. Create in us humble hearts this Lenten season as we answer the call into the hall to follow. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And now join me in the assurance of grace.
Through Christ, life has been given to us as a new gift each day. We are a new and different people from this moment on. Let us walk together in the steps of Christ. May God be praised.
This morning that raised me up. I thought it was appropriate for this time of year. Just very quickly, I say this with all humbleness. Some of you may be aware that I did a presentation on the Ukrainian National Anthem. I did it on our organ. I received a text from a gentleman who's of Ukrainian descent, his whole family. He's here in this country, but he forwarded it to his relatives in the Ukraine for disbursement. So I'm really honored by that. Very humbling. So keep those folks in our thoughts and concerns.
And now the kids come forward. And how are you? Good. Yeah, okay. Now, I think if I put this here, do you think we can all use it? Okay, I'll just kind of go like this. All right, good. Well, I would like to talk about kindness today. You know how we have Miss Mary Lynn, who's always talking about kindness? She's kind of like that person. Well, I was reading one of my favorite theologians is Mr. Rogers. What's a theologian? Anybody know? Person that talks with God, who studies God, and, you know, loves God. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. Okay, Logan, I expect you to know these things because you're very wise. You are. Very wise. Anyways, so I was reading him, and he said there are three things to do in life to be successful. The first one is be kind. The second one is be kind. And the third one is be kind. I thought, oh. Well, I told my granddaughter, she's six. Anybody here 6 years old? Oh, hey, yeah. She looks at me and goes, Grandma, why did you say that three times? I said, because that's what Mr. Rogers said. Now, why do you think he said that three times? Okay, Logan?
Because one of the only things that you have to do in life is be kind, because all you gotta do, even if you get hurt, doesn't matter, you can't be kind. Basically saying being kind is almost the most important thing in life, because not even school or work or so always be kind.
Be kind, right. Anybody else have some thoughts? You sure? How about you, Sophia? You want to say anything?
No.
Well, and think about it. Now, how can you be kind?
Like not bullying anybody.
Okay, not bullying. I know one. Two girls right here, they're doing a can drive and battle drive for what?
The American Heart Association for the kids who have like bad hearts and stuff.
I think that's being very kind, don't you? Mm-hmm. How about you, Sophia? How can you be kind? Can you be kind to your brother?
If my mom is just doing everything by herself, I will help her.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Can we get that on tape, you know? We'll need it later in life, she will need it. Okay, all right, anything else? How about you?
Sharing stuff with my sister.
Sharing stuff with my sister, okay. And I'm sure all of you know ways to be kind. Is that not true? They're all kids inside those grown-up bodies, you know? Yeah. Charles. Okay. All right. So I think Mr. Rogers really has a good point about kindness, don't you? All right. I think that's where I want to leave this. And what I'd like to do is now say the Lord's Prayer. Who'd like to start? Logan?
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you all. All right. Now, Mary Lynn is not here today. I don't know if you may have to. I do have a story in my sermon if you have to stay in. You know, at least that's the good part, okay? All right, so let's.
Or do you want me to take them off?
Well, you don't have to. You know what? I don't think we'll be. It's up to you. Yeah.
You guys want to stay or do you want to go off?
You know what? I remember being here in this church. Together in prayer, and somebody, They knock something over?
Oh, okay.
There are many on our prayer list, and are there those we'd like to lift up today? Does anybody have anyone? Yes.
Ellen Hawkers, Jane, she is finally home from the hospital, but she still has to go back. She's supposed to have a bone marrow transplant.
Okay.
And they have to do another round of chemo for the transplant.
All right, did you all hear that? Her friend, Jane, is home from the hospital, but she does have to go back. She's going to have another round of chemo before she has a bone marrow transplant. Okay, anyone else? Yeah, yeah.
Lifting up Mary Lynn, her brother's in the hospital, and she's got a lot on her plate right now. So prayers for her and her family.
Prayers for Mary Lynn and her family. And Jim is in the hospital, her brother, and that's her only brother, that's her only sibling, so. Okay. All right, anyone else? All right. We have received prayers this week, and Catherine, our hearts go with you as you travel home for the funeral memorial service for your brother-in-law, Alan, who passed away. And also our prayers go to you and John on the passing of his uncle, Dick, in Watertown. So.
North Hudson, Adirondacks.
I'm sorry?
North Hudson, and up in the Adirondacks.
Okay, up in the Adirondacks. All right. We have continued prayers for Norma's daughter, Kathy, who's undergoing chemo, for Elaine, Dee, who's recovering from pneumonia. The people of Ukraine, we keep them in our hearts. And listening to how Poland has been so open to having people come and stay with them. I mean, people are opening their homes and, you know, just taking people in from the Ukraine. What a wonderful gift. For Donna and Spence's son, who's undergoing 3 weeks of radiation. And for Gina, who is her daughter, or daughter-in-law, his wife anyways, it's her daughter-in-law. And all the caregivers, we keep them in our prayers. For Stephanie, who's undergoing radiation therapy. For Mary Lynn, again, and her brother Jim and family. For Mike, who's having a PET scan this week. He has a mass near his lung. And that is that a friend of yours, Mike? No.
No, Bob Drain.
Who?
Bob Drain.
Bob Drain. Oh, thank you. Let me just note that. For Catherine's sister Jeanette, who is not doing well, so we keep her in our prayers. And for Joan, as she grows stronger, for Beth, she suffered a concussion. I talked to her on the phone the other day, and she also has a date for her wrist surgery. She has to go to Pennsylvania, I think it's Philadelphia, I think that's what you said, Jan, right, for the surgery. For Rena's nephew, Matthew. We keep him in our prayers. For Amanda, for Jan's friend Jim, who is now in palliative care, and for his wife, Marcia, who Jan worked with for a lot of years. For Jean's friend Steve, as he walks his final walk.
Tim.
Oh, for Tim. Thank you. All right. For Susan's daughter, Deborah. Her tumor was found to be benign. Wilma, as she grieves the passing of her husband, Bob. And for Pat, whose son, Mike, was hospitalized. We ask the Lord, hear our prayer. Continue prayers of comfort for the Bob Spike family. And is it Tim who passed, or Tim or Steve who passed away?
Steve was my cousin and passed away last fall.
And who did Tim attend? Yeah, okay.
A high school friend.
Yeah. And we keep that family in our prayers, Jean. I mean, it's so hard. And all of you, the friends, like you said, high school friends. We also ask God's blessing be with Bill's family members, Lisa and her husband, Tony, for LaRue's brother, Ellen, for Evie, for Art and Priscilla, for Wendy and Bill, Richard and Norma, and Don and his family and Ann. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the Ensman family. Linda is, you know, it's so fresh when you lose your mother, and we just keep Linda in our prayers. And for all who have lost family members to COVID, friends and family to COVID, Lord, hear our prayer. Healing for Michelle's friend Jill, who's undergoing chemo treatments, for Kaylee, Jan and Steve's daughter, for Becky, who underwent back surgery, Edie, who is meeting her heart issues, these challenges head on, and she didn't make it to Harmony Circle the other night.
No, so. She's staying in.
Yeah, she's staying in, so, yeah. You know, let's keep her in our prayers. For Donna, who's praying for her grandson Will and her son Bill, and is celebrating grandson Carl's swimming victories. And for Mary D, who has problems breathing. I know she had bronchitis. I don't know if the bronchitis is now subsided, but it just sounds like she's going to have breathing problems for a while. For Rena's sister Kim, Kim is suffering the long-term effects of COVID, including a flare-up of shingles. And we have a prayer of thanksgiving that Emily's, the masses in her breast area were found to be benign. So that's good. And for Shar's family member, who's been clean for over 30 days, that is a wonderful thing. And Sue's friend Sherry, who is recovering from pneumonia. I talked to Sherry yesterday. She's going to go back to her therapy. She has cancer and will be starting that up again. For Rena, who has prayers for a 13-year-old Skylar who's battling cancer, and for her family, because the outcome does not look real positive. So, we have prayers of compassion and love for our shut-ins, for Jim, Priscilla, Cynthia, Jane, Dorothy, and Alex, and for all those in assisted living and nursing homes. We pray for the caregivers, for the families, and the friends. Lord, hear our prayer. Prayers for our military men and women and their families who are deployed here at home and around the world during this intense time of world strife. Prayers for our leadership, President Biden, Vice President Harris, and for members of Congress, and that all our world leaders, may they have common sense and may common sense prevail. Lord, hear our prayer. Prayers of strength and courage for all who battle cancer, for Skylar, Paula, Stephanie, and Donna, for Ellen and Sherry, for Jeanette and Jane, may they know God's loving presence. Lord, hear our prayer. And we pray, Lord God, for all of us here in this church, that we may be your hands and your heart in this community, that we may be there for those who are suffering, for those who need healing. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. The bulletin has walked away. Okay, got it. Thanks, Sal.
Reading from the Old Testament, Lamentations 1, verse 1 and 2. How lonely sits the city that was full of people. How like a widow has she become. She that was great among the nations, she that was a princess among the cities, has become a vassal. She weeps bitterly at the night, tears on her cheeks. Among her lovers, she has none to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. So ends the reading of God's holy word. Thanks be to God. And now a reading from the New Testament. Please join me. This is Luke 13, verse 31 through 35. At that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you."
He said to them, "Go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow. And after the day, I finish my work. Today, tomorrow, and the next day, I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem.
Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it.
How often have I desired to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing.
See, your house is left to you, and I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. So ends the reading of God's holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Lent's a messy time. It's snowy, it's muddy. It's a time of transformation of both the land and the soul. And I used to look out the landscape and see plastic bags caught in the trees. You know, people would just, you know, the plastic bags from like White Men's and stores. Well, now I look down and see the blue mass on the ground at the CVS parking lot near, you know, the trash cans. I digress, I know. But Lent is messy. And we need to open our eyes and our hearts and set our feet on the path to faithfulness. It is time to look at our relationship with God, to look at the spiritual path we have chosen to journey. Lent is never quite long enough for us to reflect on all that weighs us down. But Lent is a good place for us to begin. Let's walk with Jesus. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He's on his way to the cross. And guess who warns Jesus that Herod Antipas, the successor to the evil King Herod of the Nativity story, you know, he's the ruler of Israel, wants to kill him, that he should get away from the Galilee region. You got it. The Pharisees are the ones who warn Jesus to leave town. Yep. Well, Jesus understands that this is not a black and white issue for the Pharisees or Herod. How often we hear how the Pharisees are disparaged in Scripture. How often we hear them criticized in the Gospels. These religious men who are now coming to warn Jesus. Well, Jesus also understands that Herod is motivated by fear and his hunger for power. He wants the people of the Galilee region to bend to his way of thinking, to bend to the Roman Empire. Herod Antipas has his eyes on bigger things in the Roman Empire than this backwater region known as Galilee. And this guy, Jesus, here he is threatening his ambitions. What with his message of repentance and remaining faithful to the ancient promises of the God of Israel. Jesus understands that both the Hebrew religious leaders and the Roman leaders are not keen on his interpretation of the scriptures, especially when he preaches that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. How does Jesus react to the warning of the Pharisees? He brushes away Herod's evil threats and announces his plan to the Pharisees. I have some healing and casting out demons to do in the next couple of days, and I will be on my way to Jerusalem. And this is left unsaid in the scriptures, but maybe, just maybe, the Pharisees are being a little bit self-serving in telling Jesus to leave town because Herod Antipas wants to kill him. Perhaps they would like Jesus to take his message of the first shall be last and the last shall be first, and hit the road and leave the Galilee so that Herod Antipas will take the heat off from them, off the Pharisees. All those in power do not want to hear Jesus' message. Not the small-time politician Herod, not the religious hierarchy, not the Pharisees, not the Roman leaders, no one. They don't like Jesus stirring up the message. And they don't like the message that he is bringing. And they don't like him stirring up the people, with his ancient words of faithfulness and covenant with the God of Israel. They do not want to share power, wealth, or authority with the people. Jesus is a prophet of the ancient tradition, offering both warning and comfort. Return to God, or God cannot help you. God has compassion for you, his chosen people, but you need to choose God. God will not impose God's will on the people. Jesus is the embodiment of these old prophetic promises of mercy and compassion, of God's unwavering love of God's people, and Jesus laments over Jerusalem. You can hear the heartbreak in his image of wanting to gather his people, like the hen gathering her brood under her wings. Listen to the words of Jesus once again. How often I have desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. A story. Many of you may know this story. It's an old story. The forest fire had been brought under control. The group of firefighters were working their way back through the devastation, making sure the hot spots were extinguished. They had marched across the blackened landscape between the wisp of smoke still rising from the smoldering remains. A large lump was found on the trail, and it caught one of the firefighters' eyes. As he got closer, he noticed that the charred remains were the remains of a large bird. It had burned nearly halfway through. Since the bird could have easily flown away when the fire approached, the firefighter wondered what must have been wrong with this bird. Was it diseased? It couldn't escape? Was it injured? Arriving at the carcass, he decided to kick it off the trail. As soon as he did, he was startled by the flurry of activity around his feet. Four little birds flailing in the dust and ash, then scurried away down the hillside. The bulk of the mother's body had covered them from the searing flames. Though the heat was enough to consume her, it allowed her, babies, to find safety underneath. In the face of the rising flames, she had stayed with her young. Her dead carcass and her fleeing chicks told the story well enough. She gave the ultimate sacrifice to save her young. Now, the bird in the story was the only chance those chicks had for safety. She, being willing to spare her life, had gathered them up under her wings to herself. At the point of terrible pain and death, when she might have still saved herself, she chose to stay through the ordeal. She chose to stay. Jesus understood that pain as he got closer and closer to Jerusalem, and how he wanted to gather us under his wing, just as the mother bird gathered her chicks under her wings. We hear more broken-hearted words of the prophet. You know, when you think about what Jeremiah was saying, he was lamenting the destruction of his beloved Jerusalem and how she sits lonely, how her people were exiled, how she was once a princess and now she is like a widow, how she weeps bitterly, just bitterly, because there's no one there to comfort her. Her friends had betrayed her and had become her enemies. As Jesus envisions Jerusalem, he understands that the people of Israel are stiff-necked. This people will not willingly listen to his message of mercy and love. They will know heartache once again, as in the time of Jeremiah. Both Jeremiah and Jesus understood that they could not stand between Jerusalem and heartache. The temple will be destroyed again. The people will be dispersed, exiled from their beloved Jerusalem. And just as in the time of Jeremiah, they too thought that the God of Israel would save them because God always resided in the temple and always would protect them. But Jesus, like Jeremiah, knew, even before he entered the city of power, the city of all things political and religious, that God would leave. They did not turn. They did not shuv, as they say in the Hebrew. They did not turn back to God. And he cried for the very ones who will reject him. And yet Jesus is firm. He is firm in his resolve that lies ahead in Jerusalem, even if it means forfeiting his own life. As we imagine how Jesus wants to protect the people, like the hen protected her chicks gathered under her wings, perhaps he, like the hen, excuse me, hopes that the fire will only take her and be satisfied to leave her chicks. Excuse me. Like the mother hen, Jesus is determined to face what lies ahead. Whatever Herod has planned for him, he is determined to be there for his people. He's determined to be there for us, for each one of us. Each one of us. And we hear the call to stand firm for what we as Christians believe. Jesus didn't back down or run away from what he knew was his fate. In fact, he didn't run away or back down because he knows that God is, he knows who God is. He walks with God and what is right. This is the Jesus with whom we walk into Lent. This is the man with whom we walk and is with us no matter what, the risk or what we may encounter. Jesus walks with us. As I said, Lent's a hard time. As I think of Jeremiah and Jesus lamenting over the fate of Israel, my heart breaks. Luke's Jesus, in a true prophetic sense, can see what will happen to Jerusalem not long after his death. The temple destruction, 70 AD. The people who follow him, the Christ followers, they'll be kicked out of the temple. They will be persecuted. Yet Jesus never gave up hope. He tells the Pharisees that he has work to do, that he will live his life on his terms. That's hope. Lent is the time we gather like the chicks under the wing of God as the body of Christ, where we take shelter and find warmth and safety as we are called to look into our own hearts and our own history, and repent. Amen. Offerings. It's the time when we can give back to our church, give back to this church on the hill. We'll now have the morning offering.
Okay, so you finish first.
wisely in our community. In the name of all that is holy, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Joy, joy, joy. Are we going to do the joy jar today? Yes? Let's. We have joys, don't we? Please tell me you have joys. Come on.
I have a joy.
Oh, good. Let's do it.
Compared to last week, I had none.
Oh, okay. But you still did it. Joy, joy, joy. She has to go do coffee hour.
I'll hand it off.
Okay, Sale can hold it maybe. Oh, yeah, you're done? Okay, first.
For the Ukraine people, and in the hopes that this is the last winter blast.
Mm. Amen.
Rejoice!
Rejoice. Ah, oh, sorry.
Emmanuel.
That's it. It's not.
My computer. A couple weeks ago said, nah, I don't want you talking to the internet anymore. I've had enough of this. So sending out emails to you guys was non-existent. And I'm sure you celebrated. However, I got a new computer. Yay! And it talks to the internet. Yay! So you're getting more emails from me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Rainy.
Hi.
Okay.
This is for my brother Don's surgery the ninth, whenever that day was. Mm-hmm. The surgery went fine. There was 4 or 5 very large calcium deposits in his kidney, but they were able to extract them from his back, and he was over and came home. So that was good. Thank you for your prayers. My nephew Brett is a deputy of the Sheriff's Department, and he was on Channel 10 News the other day. He's going to be a canine officer now, so that's wonderful news. And this is for Matthew. He was contacted by the American Dental Association, someone at the American Dental Association in Chicago, to be recruited, and after a month and a half of interviews, he accepted a job working for the ADA in Chicago. So he's there now trying to find apartments.
Oh,
they're like tiny, like 500-600 square feet. And he starts April 1st from Boise and then May 1st in Chicago. So he's east side of the Mississippi. So getting closer. Yeah. So, yes, that's for him.
Oh, thank you. That's great news. Okay, Jan.
Yes, for the people of Ukraine, and after church, we get to go for a bye-bye ride to the dollar store with Logan and Sophia. As soon as he walked in this morning, can we go for a bye-bye ride? Church.
Thank you, Jan.
Yes. It's good to be back, and after a nice visit in Alabama, we got a chance to stop north of Atlanta and see my brother. And I got to see all of Atlanta because my navigator could have read my writing, and Garmin said I'm not working, and we drove around Atlanta until I got back up north again and just pulled off the road and called my sister-in-law to come and find us. And thank you for your prayers for our friend Tim. He did it his way, and he passed last Thursday very comfortably after seeing all the family, and all the family was there.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
You're it.
I'm it. The cow's tail.
The cow's tail.
I'll think of a joy. I do have a joy. The other day I saw several of my little daddies coming. Now they're married, but they're there, and they will be alone.
You know, I've seen robins, I've seen red-winged blackbirds. I'm so excited. They're harbingers of spring. Hi, Bobby.
Not much social life, huh?
None.
And I, too, have seen a lot of robins and blackbirds. In fact, as they ate my bird feeder out this morning.
Oh,
so.
Yeah, they can be.
So that's for them, and the rest is for Ukrainian people.
Thank you. Oh, Kathleen's got one.
I got it right.
Okay.
This is just a joy for everyone who's sent cards, condolences cards and everything. I'm so thankful, you know, as I feel like I'm soaked in grief with two losses, I also feel like I'm enveloped with love
on this church.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you all. We are truly blessed in this church, truly blessed. Okay, our closing hymn is 584, I am the light of the world.
That's right.
Okay,
yeah.
Please stand if you're able. People say,
Amen.